Good afternoon, everyone. Could you please grab some food and take a seat? We're about to begin. I'd like to welcome you all to What Matters to Me and Why. I'm very grateful to the Office of Religious Life at the Levin Institute for Humanities and Ethics for co-sponsoring. As you know, this is our 10th year, and we've been going back and forth between this venue and Ground Zero. And we'll take a vote at the end of the year and see what you prefer. But I'm very grateful to all of you for being here this afternoon. You know, we've had some bad news this week. As many of you heard, one of our first-year students, Jackson Rodney, fell out of a sixth-floor window and is in critical condition. It's a very tragic event. And we've put out a book in the little Chapel of Silence near Town and Gown, a book where you can record prayers or thoughts or well wishes. That book will go to him and his family. So if you feel inspired, please go write something in there and say a prayer for Jackson. I'd also like to announce a few upcoming events. There's more information on this table. One in particular is happening next week, which is November 11th, Thursday at 7:30 in this room. Office of Religious Life and USC Spectrum presents a book talk with Philip Goldberg. The book is called American Veda, from Emerson and Thoreau to the Beatles to yoga and meditation, how Indian spirituality has shaped the West. So it should be an interesting book event. If you're interested in the topic, there'll be a book signing and sale afterwards. You'll get to meet the author, etc. So I invite you all for that. How many people saw the rally to restore sanity and or fear this weekend? Well, you know, I thought it was a really eloquent and interesting examination of the role of media and journalism in shaping our civic life as Americans. Our presenter today really wrestles with these very important ideas and issues every day. That's the domain in which he resides. And so to introduce our very special presenter today, I'm happy to introduce a member of our student committee, Christina Crone, who I found out will play Geneva as a young woman in Geneva's upcoming biopic, so stay tuned for that.
Well, this thing is very tall. I am not. Anyway, so Geneva Overholser has won more awards and held more prestigious positions in the world of journalism than I have time to list today. Though two of my favorites are her leading the Des Moines Register as an editor to winning the Pulitzer Prize in public service and being a member of the editorial board for one of my favorite newspapers ever, the New York Times. Today she serves as the director of USC's Annenberg School of Journalism and is also a professor. So please help me in welcoming Geneva Overholser.
I should be so lucky as to have Christina playing me in my biopic, not to mention to have a biopic. I want to thank you all. Varun, it's such a pleasure to see you, my neighbor here. We both live downtown, to see several good friends in the audience. Thanks for coming. And what an honor it is for me to be able to be part of this wonderful occasion. I think it's so rare that we take a moment to reflect on what matters to us and why, and what a great idea to have a session whose purpose is that. I'm a preacher's kid, so you'd think that I would take moments to reflect on what matters to me and why, but I'm also a journalist, and of course reflection, as some of you would agree, is not always the strongest characteristic that comes to mind. When I sat down and tried to think about what one word would stand out for me, I came up with an appallingly practical and unspiritual sounding word. Is this right for the mic? Is this about right? Do you want me to talk lower or higher? And that remarkably unspiritual sounding word is balance. And I thought, why is that the word that I feel matters to me so much? Maybe it's partly because I'm 62 and I've reached a time in my life where I realize how many things are important to me. I mean, our lives are so filled with gifts and blessings and challenges and struggles, and the need to balance so that you are able to cherish what matters to you, the many different things that matter to you, strikes me as absolutely essential. And so as I tried to list kind of the most outstanding of those things, One, of course, is meaningful work. I've been blessed in my life to do work that means an enormous amount to me. Somebody on my faculty the other day said, you know, you're really a populist is what you are. And I thought, how can you not be a journalist and be a populist? How can you be a journalist and not be a populist? You fundamentally believe when you're in journalism that you are about the business of enabling people to live richer, fuller lives and to govern themselves more intelligently. So, you know, it speaks of a belief in people. Certainly, that has been a constant in my life. And the blessing of having meaningful work has been as well. As you all know now, journalism is in a time of enormous change. And I consider that a great opportunity to make a difference in the world of journalism by leading a journalism school which has resources to help reinvent this really important public function of ensuring a continued flow of high-quality information. Journalism tends to be a mission for those of us who practice it. And I remember the other day sitting down by a couple of parents whose kid, a bright-eyed, eager, young freshman broadcast journalism major. And the father turned to me and he said, well, I think journalism is really good preparation for other kinds of work. Don't you think? I think she could go to law school and she could. And I said, well, she surely could. Yes, it's a great preparation. Many people think it's sort of the new English major, but with technology and entrepreneurial thinking added. But I have a feeling she might stick with journalism because when people fall in love with it, as obviously your daughter did in high school, it tends to really get you and keep you. So one of them is meaningful work. Another is health and physical well-being and enjoying the outdoors. I know many of you in this room must feel as strongly as I do that when I'm taking care of my body, I am so much better able to think about my soul and my mind and all the rest of the things that mean so much to us. And I have found Los Angeles such a gift. My husband and I are hikers, as are all of our children. And before I moved to LA 2 years ago, I knew it was a fabulous, fabulously beautiful place to be on the beach. But I had no idea what a wonderful mountain city it is. I'm sure many of you know, but almost every weekend we're in the San Gabriels or the Verduros or the Santa Monicas, and it's just such a blessing to have these beautiful mountains here. You know, you can just walk to fall, and you can walk to winter, and it's just a great blessing. Obviously, family and friends and love mean the world to me, and I have been through a painful divorce, which was extremely difficult for my children, and have found love late in my life that has just kind of blown me away with its power and its wonderful companionship. And I'm aware of the pain and the loss, but also of the gift. I have three children. One came with the second marriage, and two daughters. One of them does look a little like Christina, in fact. And they're a great blessing to me, and I have been both a difficult and wonderful mother, I hope, to them. They say both. And then I wanted to name the arts, which are so important to us in helping us define ourselves as human beings in relationship to other human experiences. You know, there's great jazz in LA. You have to drive too damn far to get to it. But we moved downtown, and there's a wonderful jazz club called the Blue Whale that I recommend to you that's in Little Tokyo. Really terrific, terrific jazz, which we frequent. Books are my addiction, theater. So a balance of all these things, which is so hard to achieve, and my children would definitely say I did not achieve it. They would say that I was working too hard when I was editing a newspaper. I, of course, would have said that as a good feminist who was also a journalist, I was balancing my life a hell of a lot better than most of the newspaper editors were balancing theirs. And I came home for dinner, and I didn't do that, and I didn't do this, and didn't travel all the time. And, you know, it was hard. It was a struggle. But whenever I get to patting myself on the back for what a balance I thought I was instituting, my children kind of roll their eyes. They would not say that I had struck a balance, and I think it's a constant challenge. I feel that challenge now. thinking about myself as a preacher's kid and the degree to which I don't think enough about what matters to me. I don't really reflect enough, very purposefully and mindfully, on my values and whether I'm living by my values and whether I'm questioning and whether I'm talking with others whose experiences can be enlightening for me. And the clear answer I come up with is indeed not. My father was a minister in the Southern Presbyterian Church, and he was frustrated in his work and kept going to little, we moved every 3 or 4 years. I went to 3 different high schools, great preparation for journalism. You know, you just go up to strangers and introduce yourself. But he was always frustrated in his work. He kept going to these little communities where people mostly wanted him to reassure them that they were the most just and righteous and good-hearted people in the world. And Dad was always the teacher by inclination and wanted to challenge people, which wasn't a big hit. And for his time and for his place, he was something of a social progressive. So, you know, he left the ministry and went into teaching philosophy, as a matter of fact. I was just telling Christina this, and he, I thought about what that struggle of his meant to me as in my own spiritual quest. And I know later he was disappointed that I had not, my first husband was Catholic and I was a Presbyterian and we were both fallen away and we lived in Paris. And I remember Dad coming one time saying, you know, you need to go to church. Whatever church you pick, you need to go to church, some kind of spiritual life. You just need to go to church. He was always disappointed that I wasn't. And later I did, with my now husband, join a church and was glad that I did. Although now I have to say I'm not a regular participant in organized religion. And I realized that one thing that happens to me every week that is the closest thing to that, and it's wonderful. Our son is a recovering alcoholic, and every Wednesday night, I'm looking forward to getting on the train to Long Beach now, we at 5 o'clock today, we go down to Long Beach where he is part of a AA meeting that is made up of musicians. And they are wonderfully gifted musicians, and they're all recovering, or trying. And they offer their, some of you know AA meetings, I'm sure, people sort of stand up and offer their stories, but their version of offering their stories is playing music. And it's just an amazing meeting, and you see these people, some of whom have struggled so hard and so long, and it's just an astonishing gift, as you can tell, which really, I think, is an enormous part of my spiritual life, and I'm very grateful for it. I would say that one of the things that has defined my quest for meaning in life has been the fact that I am both a feminist and a journalist. And for much of my life, those two things were kind of uncomfortable cohabitants of a world, because, you know, lots of feminists thought that journalists were not very good about reporting on emerging progressive thinking, and lots of journalists thought that, you know, feminists were wild-eyed whatevers. And whenever I did want to, I mean, newsrooms, let me say, have not been particularly feminist places. I mean, they have definitely not. And, you know, news judgment was defined by some pretty traditional standards. And so if you're in a newsroom and you think differently at all, if you're young, if you're a person of color, if you're a woman who wants to be true to certain ideals, you're gonna, you know, everybody has these experiences where you question, and questioning is often uncomfortable. So I found that an interesting tension. But I think it's been really important to me, and it's defined some of the most important moments in my life, and I think that I particularly admire courage and straightforwardness. And I have found that when I have made perhaps the strongest contributions that I've been able to make in my life, they have depended on that combination of caring about women's rights and caring about the power of journalism. And Christina mentioned the Pulitzer that we won at the Des Moines Register, which was about a woman who wanted her story told. She had been raped, and she didn't buy this notion that you should go and hide in a dark corner. And so it was quite a powerful experience. So I have been very lucky in my life, and I am very grateful for the wonderful work I've gotten to do. I think that I've come to realize that while I've had the opportunity to do wonderful journalism, I have myself less talent as a journalist than the people whom I have been given the privilege of leading. And so when I became a newspaper editor after years of being a reporter and an editorial writer, I think I was able to acknowledge this, you know, and feel kind of the feeling that I think orchestra conductors must feel when you are there with all these talented people arrayed in front of you, and your job is to enable them to do the best work they can possibly do, which is just a gloriously satisfying feeling, rewarding feeling, and it's the same feeling I have now being at Annenberg, which I think really is going to be able to make a difference in this time of enormous change and unsettlement in journalism, because we are part of a great university in a city full of diversity and in an environment that values creativity and doesn't say, you know, we've done all that, we tried that, here are the rules, go stand over here, hierarchical, rigid. This is a place where you can make change. And we have an opportunity to help reinvent journalism and make it more democratic, enabling people to have their stories told, stories that weren't told even in the golden years. And they were a lot of fun of journalism. So that's my story. I'll learn a lot more from Q&A than I will from blabbing on forever. So why don't I stop now and see if people have thoughts or questions? Yes.
I'm also a preacher's granddaughter, and I went to school here when it was the height of feminism. Although I personally have never related to that, because I come from a very rigid Armenian background, and they pride themselves on their orthodoxy, and I just always feel that sense of balance within my own life, and I feel like I do have balance, and I often use that word as my primary word and importance. That word is very important to me, but I find myself sometimes being too hard on myself, and I wonder if you do too, sometimes in seeking balance, and then maybe if you upset the card or upset people around you, whether you don't feel maybe overly conscientious about that.
Uh-huh. Well, that's a very interesting set of statements, yes. I want to ask you how you feel you achieve balance, but let me try first to, yes, you know, I think it's a great blessing, actually, it's a great blessing to be youthful, but one of the great blessings of achieving a certain age is I have found, at least, that I care less. I don't mean I want to be ruthless or that I don't give a damn what people think of me or something, but I care much less, you know, I'm much less likely to be all eaten up by somebody's apparent negative view of me, and that is a great liberation. So, but yes, I think so. I think we're all alternatingly too hard. Most of us are too hard on ourselves sometime, and then other times let ourselves off the hook way too much. So how have you achieved that balance that you feel that you have?
Well, I just fulfilled all the oaths that I made with my grandparents. They were Armenian survivors of the genocide, Armenian genocide. Their friends were much more affected by the genocide than they were, because we were told to leave Armenia, and we didn't go back, whereas most of our friends and family went back thinking that the reforms in Turkey were going to take effect, and they didn't. It ended up in the Armenian genocide. But I kept following the oaths of my grandparents. My grandfather established the first Armenian school in Montebello. He told me that he wished that I would dedicate my education to the Armenian cause. And I did. I became an attorney and worked with the Armenian Bar Association to, as Alfred Desaias says, he's a UN human rights retiree. He says that we should get all our lands back, taken so ruthlessly from us in 1950.
So you found kind of a peace by really going back and thinking about the debt you want to, or the
yeah,
service you want to do.
The oaths that I made to my ancestors.
Oh, that's wonderful.
It was very important.
That's wonderful. Yes.
What do you think the best thing you did at the Des Moines Register was, and what do you think made you able to do it?
Boy, I loved being a newspaper editor, I must say. But it was painful because they were cutting, this was at the beginning of all these cuts left and right. We were so unfortunately pioneering. The best thing I did, I do think the best thing I did, actually this is one of those things where the awards you get seem to be in direct connection to the work you did. I think the best thing I did probably was this work that won the Pulitzer, and it began in a very personal way because it began as a phone call from some, I had just left the New York Times to come back to the, I had worked at the Des Moines Register and then gone to Harvard in a Nieman Fellowship and then gone to the New York Times and come back as editor. And Alex Jones, who was then the media writer for the New York Times, called me to get a comment from me. He knew I was a good feminist and journalist, and he wanted a comment from me on why we don't usually name people who bring charges of rape. And I told him I was troubled that we don't, because I see why we don't and the special stigma, but I also felt that making this one exception in the case of adult victims of crime can really contribute to keeping this a hidden crime and kind of infantilizing. And so I said these and this stuff, and he quoted me, and then somebody asked me to do an op-ed piece for the Times, and I did an op-ed piece for the Times, and I thought, well, we should run it in the Register even though nobody will care. And then this woman who lived in Grinnell, Iowa, stepped forward and said, you know, I want my story told. And I think that it was a coming together of so many things in my life. And we really did important work. It's hard to take this back to 1982, I guess, was when the story was published. But you just did not talk about rape. I mean, you just did not talk about it in this country. And we really did help bring this difficult, painful issue out into the public eye. I suppose it was our 15-minute, there's one magazine cover that says, "The woman who put rape on the front page," and there I am smiling. this will be in my obit. but I think it did make a difference, and I felt privileged to have been part of it. I think we handled the story well. It was brave. The woman who stepped forward was brave, but I think it was. But you know, I just loved every moment almost of that job, and I felt great about it. But it sure as hell was not a balanced period in my life. Thank you for asking that. Yes?
You mentioned that you were able to balance being an editor and having a family.
Or so I thought.
Yeah, more successfully than some other editors. I was wondering if you could elaborate on how you were able to draw that.
Well, the reason I say more successfully than others is that, first of all, there were very few women editors of major newspapers, and the few there were literally either were married with no children or had never married. And so, I mean, I did it more successfully than others because at least I did it, you know. But I think that part of what I meant was that I was more, you know, I did take time away from the job. I mean, I'd go to my publisher and say, I'm going to my daughter's diving meet, and I went home, you know, and had dinner, which is not all that common occurrence. I mean, it sounds ridiculous to make big claims for that, but I think I was much more mindful of the need and the wish to do that. But I think my kids actually would say they thought it was a very, one of them is finishing her MBA at Cornell and the other is finishing her law degree at Berkeley, and they have wonderful love in their lives and they're wonderful young women. And I think they would say that it was a really interesting experience. It wasn't easy being the newspaper editor's daughter in other ways, of course, because your friends' parents hate you, you know. but I think they would say, you know, but I think what suffered was my marriage, and my marriage ended, as a matter of fact. So, you know, is that a story of success? I mean, things have worked out, I think, for everyone in the end, including my former husband who remarried and seems quite happy. But, you know, life is so full of things you think you're on top of when all of a sudden, you know, you're not, I think. And one piece of advice I often give to my students is that if you try too hard to really control you know, really, I know you want to lead your life. You don't want it to, you know, lead you around. You want to be, but if you think that you're, you know, every decision you make is going to be the determinative decision and it's got to be perfect, to, you know, this first job, or that's just not the way life is. It's not that linear. It's much more, you know, you can do things in sequence, or you can, one part of your life will be very much work-oriented and another part will be very much family-oriented, or you'll have your life, your work life will take a turn you never imagined. So, you know, there's a great deal to be said for, I've wandered away from your question, but there's a great deal to be said for understanding that life will bring you riches and gifts, as well as sorrows and tragedies that you never would have guessed, nor can you prepare for them, really. And that's okay. I mean, I think that's kind of one of life's, yes, yes.
I'm an NPR student as well. I wonder how you deal with the expectations from others. For you, you said your parents, your father's disappointment in you not getting engaged enough in a religious life, and probably your family would want you to devote more time in your family and your marriage, less to your work. And for me, my parents want me to just get married and have a family, not pursuing a career as a Chinese woman. So I just wonder how you deal with the expectations of yourself, you know, from your home and the expectations of the people that you love.
That's a wonderful question. You know, patiently and steadfastly is how you deal with it. I think because you love your parents and you don't want to be a disappointment to them, and yet you can't possibly live their lives. You've got to live your own life. And I think helping them understand to the degree that you can, but then really, I have to admit that I did it partly in rebellion. My father, I mean, this is an absurd thing to say. My sister is a very successful academic. She was the president of Duke and the president of Wellesley. And people often meet us and say, my goodness, you two are so accomplished. Your father must have been so supportive. Well, I remember my father saying to me that one time that a woman's greatest glory is her hair. No, I don't mean to make my dad sound like such a buffoon, but he was a very, very, I mean, you know, he'd say things to me like, you are ambitious like your mother, you know, like this is some terrible curse or something. So part of it for me was rebellion, and at some point you will rebel against if it feels like a ceiling, you know, you're going to have to push against it, because this is your life to live. But your parents have already shown that they recognize you as a gifted individual to send you over here and, you know, go along with this whole get a really good education notion and do it abroad. I mean, I have a feeling your parents may have some inkling that your life might not go exactly in the old traditional, conventional way. Keep them posted as much as you can on what you're feeling. They'll begin to take pride in the things that you accomplish. Sort of. My father, when I went to go to the New York Times, said something like, well, I don't want my grandchildren raised in New York. I'm going to work for the New York Times. Anyway, the truth is he was proud of me. And your parents will be too. But it might take a little rebellion. Who else? Yes, back in the back.
Where do you see the future of journalism going? Obviously, the challenges for newspapers now and everything being so free all over the internet. Where do you see the future?
Well, I think that nobody knows. We are at the very beginning of a revolution. I think the opportunities to make it better really do exist. People want to be involved. It's not that people no longer want reliable information. They now want to be the co-creators of it, the people formerly known as the audience, as Jay Rosen says. So, how do we, as professionals, enrich this new situation with our own skills, bring the enduring values of journalism, verifiability and proportionality, into this new terrain? And how do we figure out it's going to be sustained? I mean, how are we going to sustain this? I mean, the old economic model is what broke. You know, the barriers to participation are down, so the old monopolies are gone, and it was advertising that supported newspapers, and now, of course, it can go out and find a lot of other ways to reach people. And the truth is, I think that it's going to look much more collaborative. I think we're going to find mixes of pro-am, as they say, professional and amateur. I think do what you do best and link to the rest is one of the important keys. I mean, if I were running a newspaper today, I would say to myself, what is it that I and I alone can do best? If I'm a major newspaper in a significant city, then it's probably, in my view, that kind of watchdog reporting that really does take tenacity and a deep pocketbook, an ability to be sued and withstand it, what we used to call Rolodex, so that you can reach, you know, people in power, they'll answer the phone. I mean, a number of things that are part of the sort of more professional news gathering that's been supported so that people can do this work full time. I would say to myself, okay, I'll do deep dive investigative reporting, I'll do watchdog reporting, and I'll figure out a way to support that, and it will probably be a mix of things. It'll be some advertising, it'll be some paywall stuff. We don't yet know how it's gonna work. It will be event planning, it will be offering some courses. I mean, who knows what it'll be? As somebody said the other day, I was at the Online News Association meeting in Washington, and Jim Brady, really interesting guy, he's running this thing called TBD, which is a local DC web-based news outlet. And he used to be editor of WashingtonPost.com. So somebody said to him, well, how are you going to support it? And he said, I don't know. We haven't found the silver bullet yet. It's just all shrapnel. So the truth is, we don't know. But I absolutely believe that we can, if we make the right choices, and if we educate our students to be leaders in its reinvention, then it can be better than ever. I also believe journalism is the new English major, so if your kids are going to law school, send them anyway. Who else? I'd be happy to hear your stories of your own. Yes, Bryce.
Other than the stories you've already mentioned, give us one or two stories that have given you most satisfaction having worked on as a journalist.
Well, when I first went to the New York Times, I was on the editorial board of the New York Times, as Christina said, and that, what that really means is you're an editorial writer, as you know, having worked at the time. And I was the youngest member of the board. I was the only mother, you know. But the thing that really made me weird was that I was coming from Iowa. That's the thing. We'd sit around the table, the editorial board, and talk about the various topics. And they'd turn to me and they'd say, well, what do they think out there about so-and-so? It was like, you know, that coffee cup with here's New York and here's the rest of America. And I was supposed to be the spokesperson for everything else. Well, it was an odd thing. I think you've experienced this, Bryce. A lot of people, when they get to a place like the New York Times, I mean, there's this feeling that it's hard really to become a part of it. It's so storied and it's so, you probably didn't feel that way. I felt that way. And especially with these various oddities about me. And I was writing about Soviet-US relations. I had just finished my Nieman year and spent quite a bit of time thinking about this. And I had spent 5 years overseas before that. And I was really interested in these topics. And this was when perestroika, the openness in the Soviet Union, was just coming about. And I came in one day and said that Gorbachev had given this remarkable speech. Well, of course, everybody around the table looked at, you know, one another like, this corn pone from Iowa thinks that you're supposed to listen to a general secretary of the USSR. Hello. You know, like, do you like their constitution too? Because they don't observe it. And I mean, they really did just think I was an idiot. And gradually, of course, it became clear that glasnost and perestroika really amounted to something. And I'll never forget, when I left, the editorial page editor stood up and said, he remembered this day, and he stood up and said, I just want to acknowledge that, you know, you were the one who brought glasnost to us, sort of openness to us in this. And I think by the time I left the Times, I mean, I thought that was a job I would stay in forever. I loved it, and we loved New York. And by the time I left the Times, I mean, I turned down this invitation to be editor of the Des Moines Register at first, because I wanted to stay in this job. And they were very, you know, you have a great future here, you'll, you know, do this, do that. And I called the editor, a former managing editor of the Washington Post, who was the curator at the Nieman Foundation, and told him I had just turned down this job, and Howie Simon, he said, "Overholser, you're a lot stupider than I thought you were." And I think that was true. I called back and said, "Okay, I'll come. I'm going to be editor." But I left the Times reluctantly, but also feeling like I had made a real contribution, and that felt really nice to me. I don't think I was very gifted as an editorial writer. I really do think that I am less gifted as a journalist than most of the people I've had the pleasure of meeting. I think I have some gifts at leadership. You've been kind enough to say that and caught me on one the other day I wasn't doing on. But I don't think I am particularly gifted as a journalist, but I think I did make a difficult job there work, and I was proud of that. It's probably, no, we have a little more time if anybody else has a question or, yes.
Hi, you mentioned your sister was president of Wellesley and Duke. Is her name Nan?
Yes.
So, okay, I'm a student in higher education, so we studied her. Okay. So I want to know.
She has a new book out. It's called Thinking About Leadership. It's just out. She just gave it to me. I was with her in New York this weekend. I commend it to you. Nan Cohen.
That's right. So, do you two have competition for who's more successful?
No, I've conceded the territory. No, when I was editor of the Register and she was president of Wellesley, she was on the front page of Wellesley magazine and I was on the front page of Working Woman magazine. That was the one that said, you know, the woman who put rape on the front page. And somebody put these two things together in a, you know, framed thing. And I think when we were in totally different worlds, that we were just really proud of each other. I have to tell you that going into the academy, which is not, I'm a journalist. I took this job because I care so much about journalism, and I think this journalism school can really make a difference. But I'm not trying to be, I could never outgun her. My brother is a associate dean of engineering at Vanderbilt. I come from a family of academics, and I was always so proud to be the black sheep who would never go into the academy. So I sort of bombed in that regard. No, I'm very proud of her, and we're so different, very different. I have been annoyed at her, you know, when she gripes about journalism, but you know, everybody does. Yes.
I'm just wondering if you have dialogues with your students about feminism, even the word and the concept seems to be by students to be something they consider to be in the 60s and 70s and done with, and women
over.
Or men don't really need to identify
right.
with feminism anymore. Does
right.
that happen in your classroom, and how do you encourage thoughts about, you know, still moving ahead with the principles that feminists?
Well, I'm embarrassed to say that I don't teach. I'm running the school and I'm kind of occupying myself. I do have weekly discussions on various topics, but I don't. So in the classroom, no. With individual women, yes, with students who've come in to talk to me. And I use the word feminist with some regularity because I think it's important for people to understand that this is a word, like any other honorable word, that speaks of a certain recognition of human rights and not of some weird, you know, underarm hair or whatever the hell is their strange conception of it. And I think it's too bad that feminism has been discredited, because why would it be? Why wouldn't we all embrace the notion of, well, I can think of several reasons, but, you know, most people, most good-hearted, open-minded people embrace the notion that women should have the full rights of their humanity. And so that's all it is to me, and but yes, I do know that. I mean, I say it purposefully, partly because I want people to hear me say it and hear that you can just say that and also say other things and be, you know, a whole full person. And I do talk to women about it. Of course, I've talked to my own daughters about it quite a lot. I don't think they say that they are feminists, but they clearly are, and I think that they're glad to be. I think that when I do talk to young women about it, mostly, it's good conversations in which people come around to realizing that they do want to embrace a sense of themselves as wanting to stand for women's rights. You know, if we don't stand for it, then who's going to stand for it? And the idea that there is no other fight to be won, I mean, these are human rights issues that will help everyone. We're all struggling with how we be young I'm not struggling as a young parent anymore, but how we balance and how do young men balance work and family life if we as a nation aren't acknowledging that these days when you just had a wife at home are, and that's how you took care of everything are over. Those are women's rights issues and human rights issues. So it's distressing to me that that word has been relegated to some kind of either, you know, that's over, aren't we glad that's over, and we went there and did that, or some rankling harridan kind of thing, you know. That's ridiculous. Yes?
How about your feminist ideology with your position now in Annenberg, not with the students, but with the hierarchy of faculty?
How has my feminist ideology been for them? Well, I don't know that, I don't know that I've encountered any real problems with it. I mean, Annenberg is very consciously diversity oriented. And I would say this is a form of diverse viewpoint that would be respected. And I don't go around, you know, jumping on tables or anything. I mean, I don't think that most people, I have perceived among some people a kind of a hesitation to engage much further, but I don't force myself on people about it. I think it's fine. I mean, I have other, I tend to be not very hierarchical, actually, which is an unusual thing for leaders in some ways. And so I think I have more trouble, there are probably other things I have more trouble with, other ways that I annoy people more than by my feminism. I don't know. We should ask some of my colleagues. There are a few in the room. Is it time?
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Geneva. And then also, just to remind everyone, next month on December 1st, James Collins is speaking. See you all then.
Thank you.